pass for the Corvette. Well, lots of traffic now.
Now, this is going to benefit John. Doc is not going to be able to get through this traffic as cleanly as he wants. John has clear track between he and Doc and should be able to close up that extra little bit.
The Corvette moves to the inside, overtaking the Jaguar first. That's the 44.
No, Doc is going to get blocked here, and that's going to cost him a little bit more time. John should be able to get right up. Look at that. Whoa, he's going to get right in his tail.
Paul Jr. almost has traffic problems there, running up on the back of John Mafucci in the Camel Lights car. Looked like Paul Jr. wanted to take a look to the inside there of Doc Bundy, but couldn't get by.
Unbelievable.
Here comes traffic. Jaguar in the spot. Whoa, and the 80 car moves into the racing line in front of Bundy.
The number 80 almost hit the 44 Jag at that point.
Oh, boy, these folks need to make way. Our leader's coming through. John Paul Jr., there is the Corvette and a Buick. One and two. You couldn't get any closer than this, folks.
John may take a stab up the inside. Here, he's going to...
The inside. John Paul Jr. may be passing. Brake lights come on, and no! Doc Bundy shuts the door. Doc Bundy holding off John Paul Jr. We have no idea what Jr.'s fuel situation is. Certainly we know that Doc Bundy should have enough fuel to get him to the finish. The question is, can John Paul go all the way as well? Down the backstretch they go.
A possibility at this stage. I believe John will have to make one more stop for fuel, and maybe he doesn't... Look at this!
Paul Jr. up on the grass. That's the number two car, the Leon Fish car, driving John Paul Jr. up onto the dirt.
Scary moment. John would be definitely over 200 miles an hour at that point. Drop tools on the dirt. You can't believe the sensations that go through your mind.
Doc Bundy continues to lead John Paul Jr. as they head into turn one and more traffic.
As I was about to say, I think what may be happening here is that John might want to stay behind Doc and just fill his mirrors up with RC Cola.
Oh, too wide there as Mafucci gets a close look at Doc Bundy in the Corvette. Another car in front. Bundy gets by. Here comes John Paul Jr.
With John knowing he has to make one pit stop, if he can force Doc into making a mistake, that would equalize the pit stop. Even if Doc is only off the track for a few seconds, that would offset John's pit stop. And maybe this is what he wants, rather than make a pass.
If he can't do it, a pit stop now for the Buick Hawk team would seal the victory for the Corvette. Assuming no problem with Doc Bundy's car. And thus far, they've had no problem. They've had all the power and speed. They've needed it when they needed it. There you see the differential. John Paul now backing off some. In fact, he seems to be going a lot slower than the vet.
Well, I just wonder if something's happened to the car or if he's decided that maybe he can't pressure Doc into a mistake and doesn't want to make a mistake himself.
Could be the fuel light blinking as well. These tanks don't run dry quickly. We'll find out in a moment. There's Doc Bundy out front. John Paul Jr. second. We'll be back for the conclusion. To go in this IMSA Camel Grand Prix event. There is your second place car, John Paul Jr. and the Buick Hawk trying desperately to overtake the pole sitting Corvette of Doc Bundy. And at this point, Bill Adam, it appears that John Paul Jr. is leaning that car out a little bit.
Well, unquestionably, the lead is again stretching. And I think what John has done is to maybe see that fuel light, realize that he does have to make a stop. There's no way to get around that, and just back off that tiny little bit.
That would certainly be a disappointment for this car. John Paul Jr. campaigned this car for an entire season last year without a finish, much less a victory. And here he comes onto pit road. Just a couple of laps to go, and it's heartbreak time for John Paul Jr. But by the other token, Bill, it has to be a happy note for them as well. If they can just hold down second place, it would be a victory for them.
Oh, definitely. It's really bittersweet at this point because you're happy the car is still running. The crew feels great. This is their gratification where they can see their days and weeks and months of hard work come to fruition. They have got a racing car that's finishing the race in second place, and they're pleased with this.
Whoa, John Paul Jr. nearly stalling there on pit road, talking about disaster. But he seems to be healthy and underway, and at this point, he's got to be thinking about holding down second place. If nothing happens to the Corvette, John Paul Jr. has still got Al Holbert breathing down his neck in the Porsche.
Yes, and here's our leader again. Doc is just going on. At this point, both Doc and John are hearing an awful lot of sounds. They're hearing noises that really don't exist, but you're so afraid of a break, and you've gone through so much frustration before that you're almost afraid to think about the possibility of doing it.
There is Doc Bundy, who used to teach at a driver's school right here at Road Atlanta, who lives just a couple of miles away in Gainesville, Georgia, on the shores of Lake Lanier. His first stint in this car under racing conditions because of breakage in earlier events. With two laps to go, as you see, Doc Bundy never had a chance to drive this Corvette under race conditions. And here, Sarel Vandemerva having gotten out, Doc Bundy may take the Corvette to its first victory.
Well, what a real dream come true as far as Doc is concerned, to give this car its first ever victory and do it on his home track. couldn't ask for a happier man right now.
Now, the preliminary reports are that Cyril Vandermeer was not well strapped in during his second driving stint, and he developed a very sore neck with about 20 laps to go. That apparently is why he got out of the car and got Doc Bundy into it. Two driver changes, four different drivers, as it were, in this car, and yet they still, in a very short endurance race, have been able to maintain the lead. That says a lot about this car.
It really does. I just noticed there as Doc came onto the straight, he's entering the straight one gear higher than he has to. That means that he's just keeping the RPM on the motor a little bit lower, really trying to baby the car at this point. You can't back off too much because you don't want your concentration to lapse. All too frequently when you start driving at a 70 or 80% capability, you make little mistakes, and this is something that Doc does not want to do. But he is being very, very careful with the car, and he won't put that car at any risk at all with only one lap to go.
One lap to go, 2.5 miles around this Road Atlanta circuit for Doc Bundy and the Corvette prototype. You'll see a few of the fans here, a record crowd at Road Atlanta, more than 50,000 people on hand as they move to the fences to watch their man go by. This is Doc Bundy, one of the most popular drivers on the IMSA circuit. And there you see, talk about people having problems. There's the Ford Probe, probably Pete Halsmer back in that car, suffering severe misfires. Both of the cars, you mentioned they were identically prepared. They seem to be having the identical problem today, Bill.
Well, I'm sure Doc felt a little bit of sorrow as he passed the Ford there because he knows what it's like to get so close to the end of a race and feel that frustration. But he won't feel too much. Right now he's thinking he's only got a couple of corners to go around and that elusive victory is finally going to be his.
Talk about irony. Doc Bundy was a part of that Ford Probe team during its first full season last year on the IMSA circuit. Doc switching over to the Chevy Corvette team this year. I would imagine he does have a little bit of sympathy toward his old friends in the other team.
Well, at this point in the track, even though he's only got a couple of corners to go, he's starting to feel the excitement. The concentration is going downhill a little bit. He knows the race is his right now, and he is getting excited.
Checkered flag should be out for Doc Bundy, and there they are.
Wonderful.
Doc Bundy and Cyril Vandermeer are the winners of the Atlanta Journal and Constitution Grand Prix.
You can see Doc's left hand up in the air. He's shaking his fist in the air and saying, I've done it.
And here comes your second place car, obviously not getting off it at all. John Paul Jr. is going to take this car to the finish, driving it every bit as fast as he did at the start.
Well, I feel particularly pleased for this team. It's my team of last year, co-driving with John. I really feel happy for this guy.
Second place points for John Paul Jr. Back in 1982, he won the championship, setting a record with 9 races, a record tied by this man, Al Hulbert, just last year. It's been a long time between good showings for John Paul Jr., but he has one. As to this point, Al Hulbert, teaming with Derek Bell once again, will finish third. You know that what they're thinking is, hey, we're as fast as anybody on this racetrack. If not for that pit stop, we would have run this race or at least had a good shot at it. And with that third place finish, Al Hulbert and Derek Bell will remain tied atop the season driver's points. And here is your Camel Lights victor, Jim Downing and John Mafucci. Downing behind the wheel right now. The first champion, the only champion this division for lightweight prototype cars has ever had. And this marks their first victory of the season on their home track.
Well, Jim has been such a good competitor over the years. He's a really wise, a very smart driver. Always brings cars home to the finish. And last season, he proved that he could do it in a GTP light car.
But the man of the hour is this man, Doc Bundy, getting his first victory in the new Corvette. First victory for the car. Finishing up his lap of honor, making his way down that long back stretch.
Isn't
considerably
that a
slower
car
than it was before. Indeed it is. A Lola chassis housing a brand new Chevrolet turbocharged V6, said to be the engine of the future.
This is a lap that Doc is going to remember for a long, long time. He will remember every inch of this track going around here, who was waving. He's just so happy. Look at this. Here he is. He's
good wave to the crowd.
He is happy.
Another little ironic note following up is Bob Tullius and Chip Robinson in the number 44 Jaguar, also a team that both you, Bill Adam, and Doc Bundy have driven for in the past.
Yeah, it's funny. We're going through half the field here talking about cars that either Doc or I have been in. At this moment, Doc doesn't care about all his history. Today, right this minute, right this second, is the most important, the most special moment of his life.
I don't know what the record might be, but there may very well be a record for wins in races run, and the Corvette that you see right here may have set some kind of a record, winning in only its 4th race. We'll be back to meet winner Doc Bundy and Cyril Vandermeer right after these messages.